Hi, everyone. Welcome to Here for the Health of It podcast. We have a great episode today. We have Nada Rutherford, who is Madame Coroner with the Richland County Coroner's Office. She is the first female coroner, first African-American coroner, and first coroner with medical experience in the entire history of the Richland County Coroner's Office. So she has all kinds of incredible insight. She talks about what it means to be a coroner, the things that she wants to see happen, and all of her fashion advice and her book, The Nada Method book on Amazon. So I hope you enjoy this. Thanks for listening. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Here for the Health of It podcast. We are Columbia's hottest podcast. I'm Dr. Randy, here with Dr. Tom, as always. And we have a great guest today, a bucket list guest for me. We have the Richland County Coroner, Nada Rutherford. And if you're looking for her on Instagram, which you have a really big Instagram following, it's spelled N-A-D-I-A Rutherford.
Nope.
N-A-D-A.
Nope.
Nope. How do we spell your name?
Oh, God.
N-A-I-D-A.
N-A-I-D-A.
R-U-T-H-E-R-F-O-R-D.
And is that your Instagram handle, too?
That
is perfect. All right. And so tell us how you got into this. This is a career that we were just saying we don't know a ton about. I'm from Canada. It's not really a thing that's talked about as much in Canada as it is here. But it seems like kind of a big position or big title.
Well, I would beg to differ. I think that before I became the coroner here in Richland County, I want you to think about the number of times that you heard about the coroner. Most people haven't.
And CSI?
Maybe. Yeah, but they don't really show the depth of work that the coroner's office is able to do and what it can do. And so when I ran in 2020, my entire goal was to make this office an office that people could relate to in times other than death and tragedy, but also be able to trust when death or tragedy occurred. So it's been an interesting journey trying to make the office relatable, approachable, and transparent while not exploiting the work that we do at the office. Mm-hmm. So the coroner just basically determines the cause and the manner of death for the citizens that die in the county.
Okay. And is fentanyl overdose a massive thing right now, as massive as we hear about?
It is. Almost every day we're telling a family that their loved one either had contact with fentanyl, even if it wasn't the major cause of death, but it's found in the mix of drugs that's in their system, in the toxicology report. Mm-hmm. It is definitely a problem in Richland County.
And is this bigger than it was in 2020 when you started? Is it growing?
Absolutely. Absolutely. What we're seeing now, and I've had some debate about this online, about whether or not fentanyl can actually be smoked in marijuana, but we believe that it can be. We've had about 25 cases where the person had THC in their system, but also fentanyl. And the only thing that the witnesses reported seeing them do before they died was smoking a joint or smoking marijuana. So we believe that they are somehow infusing the marijuana into the infusing the fentanyl into the marijuana, and they're smoking it, and it causes severe respiratory depression, meaning that the respiratory rate slows down significantly to basically where the body forgets to breathe. So you guys are doctors, you know this.
Yep.
So it really is a problem here. And I think the most interesting thing about the fentanyl overdoses is that it transcends age. So you'll have someone 17 years old all the way up to someone who's like in their 70s. The age range that we've seen with fentanyl deaths.
And today's episode is brought to you by our sponsor, Columbia Family Chiropractic, with three easy-to-get-to locations, one in Forest Acres, which is by Trader Joe's, one in O'Neill Court by the DMV, and one in the Northeast by Sand Hills. You'll be sure to have somewhere near you. They offer a ton of services, from corrective care, on-site digital x-rays, spinal decompression for bulging or herniated discs, dry needling for injuries, pediatric care, and a class 4 laser. They accept all your major insurances. And if you mention this ad, you'll get a discount on your first appointment. Check out their website at cfcforhealth.com or Google Columbia Family Chiropractic. That's cfcforhealth.com. And is it mostly people who were doing a drug and it got laced with it, or is there exposures in other places? Because I hear about police officers that can't be around somebody who had it, or maybe it was left out somewhere and somebody was exposed to it?
I think that's a little bit of fear mongering.
Yeah, that's what I was curious about.
But mostly what you see is that someone intentionally was doing the drug of their choice and it was laced with something.
Yes.
Now, I tell parents all the time, even though you may believe that your children tell you every little thing that they do, children never like they never nevered before, and they will do drugs and not tell their parents that they may do a bump of cocaine on the weekend, or for gentlemen who may have more than one job trying to take care of their families, they may do a little bump of something and it's laced with fentanyl, and they don't always know it. You can tell kind of the activity of the person, what they're looking for from their plug, from their drug dealer, and when you don't see them talk about downers or really participating in that type of drug activity, you have to know at some point that it was more than likely not their choice that the fentanyl was in there. I've known people who've done crack cocaine for 25, 30 years, and they're still alive, but this mix with fentanyl is a new thing, and unfortunately, drug dealers don't have to tell you what they put in their drugs.
It's terrifying, because yes. I have two daughters that are almost 10 and 7, and I know that it's happening in the Snapchat world is a big thing. They have special emojis that mean different drugs or different things. What else do I need to know as a parent that's happening right now?
Just really having open and honest conversations with your children. I have two teenage boys myself. They're 13 and 14. And I say things to them that they're like, Mom, please. But I want them to know that if someone gives you a Tylenol, it may not be Tylenol. Let me show you how to look up the alphanumeric on that pill so that you know what you're taking. Don't take medication from people if you don't know the source, because you could have gotten this from your grandmother's purse, but grandma may be participating in some recreational activities that you're not aware of.
Grandma?
Yeah. So
in Florida, there's this big thing where they're just all doing all kinds of drugs right now. Maybe it's South Carolina too, but I hear about it in Florida a lot.
It is. It's a problem. So just really having open, honest conversations with your children about the potential dangers, and then let them do with the information what they will. If you know they're going to a party, teach them about putting their drink down and not picking it back up if they've left it for an extensive period of time. If they didn't see someone pour it, they didn't see someone make the drink. And I'm talking about little kids. I'm talking to my 13 and 14-year-old about this. We hear about these things for like college age kids and for adult people, but our children need to be warned. And I think that it gives them information to empower them as they move forward in their social life to know where the pitfalls may be.
It's just got to be so tough seeing young people that have passed away like that.
It is.
Does it get dark sometimes?
Oh, it gets very dark. There are very dark days. These last few weeks have been pretty dark, but I think the most important part of the role that I have in the community is that I want families to have answers. So no matter how heavy the work is emotionally, I like to try to give the family some sort of peace. So the more I can use science and technology and that information to be able to give them the most accurate story possible about why their loved one died, that's the thing that helps me sleep at night. That's the thing that helps me not take this home and carry the weight of that heaviness around with me. I like being able to give them answers. So it means a lot to me to be able to say, let me show you that your son did not suffer. And here is how I know that through science. And that gives people peace. So, and I also think that my, you know, almost two decades of experience as a nurse and nurse practitioner help in that regard. So.
Yeah, your demeanor. When I think of a coroner, I normally think of someone just really behind the scenes, doesn't like talking in public, doesn't really like saying more than they necessarily need to. But I feel like you're putting on, or you're kind of bringing in like a new attitude toward being a coroner.
I am. I'm really trying to show people that this doesn't have to be some super morbid, don't talk about it kind of space. Mm-hmm. I want us to talk about the deaths that happen in our community. You want to know why? Maybe we can prevent them moving forward. I want to inform people about the problems we see on this side so that maybe they buy the pre-need insurance. Maybe they get the life insurance policy. Maybe they understand why you need those policies in place. Mm-hmm. The stuff we see on this side is so tragic. So if I can empower our community with the information that I see from the tragedies, then maybe we have a better Richland County, a better state. And I think it's a direct challenge to other coroners in other counties, in other states, in other systems. Do better, do more, because what you're doing right now is just passing time in an office. No one knows what you're doing. No one understands your role. No one understands the behind-the-scenes work that goes into a death investigation. Mm-hmm. And really, you could have someone who's in office for 20, 30 years, and they're not even working in the community to do anything. And that's the basic role of the coroner. A medical examiner, no one expects them to be out in the community. But a coroner who's elected by the people or even appointed, you should be out in the community doing more education. So I'm challenging all of them. I'm going to be the Oprah Winfrey of the coroner space, except I'm going to be Nada Rutherford.
So how does somebody know who to vote for as the coroner? If they're in,
is there normally multiple people? Because I'm thinking I almost have to force somebody into the role in my hometown.
I think it depends on the area. Yeah. Richland County is the largest coroner's office in the state. Wow. And so we have about double the staff of other coroner's offices in the state. And so here, there had really not been a new coroner since 1958.
Really?
Yeah. He died in office in 1978. The governor appointed Frank Barron, and then Frank Barron's employee ran against him, and he was the coroner until 2020 when I ran against him.
Wow.
So it's one of those things that I think you either want to do or you don't.
Yeah.
But I also think that because most of the coroner requirements are pretty lax.
Yeah.
I think that people run who maybe have experience in funeral home business, maybe they did some sort of death transportation, something like that. But I'm the first medical professional to ever be the coroner in Richland County. So prior to me, in the 173-year history as of 2020, there had never been anyone with medical training. So, people talk about me being the first African American or the first woman, but I'm y'all, that's not even the first that, makes it cool to me. I think it's pretty cool that I'm the first one to bring medical knowledge and expertise to the role. So
that's
great. You can run and be a plumber in the state of South Carolina for the most part, which is kind of sad.
That's crazy.
They're working to change things, and I think that's really important. So if someone were to want to run for coroner, I would tell them to at least take a death investigation course so that you understand the nuances of a death investigation versus a law enforcement investigation. They're two totally different things.
Huh.
Okay. Are you going to tell us about that?
This guy has all the questions. So
I feel like you led me into that one. you left me hanging for a second.
Plus you're his hero. He has a poster of you on his wall.
I love it. So all the listeners want to know. So a death investigation really tells the story of how someone died while law enforcement is looking for the criminal activity and what charges they can file. We're looking for the actual story of how the person died. How did this person come to be wedged between the dresser and their bed with an oxygen cord around their neck? Is this a homicide? Is this a suicide? Is this an accident? And so we tell the story of how the body came to be deceased.
Sure, I'm telling you, that's wild stuff.
Oh, sorry. That too much?
No. I think we want that.
No, we need that.
But I have no clue about an oxygen cord.
You're talking somebody had
a nasal cannula.
Yeah, and then they just took the cord of that. And
yeah, I feel like those would break. Maybe they're stronger than I think.
Oh, they are super strong.
Are they?
An oxygen cord?
Yeah.
I could do some major damage. But yeah. I don't kill anyone. I just want to make it clear.
You wouldn't.
I would never.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. If you mess with my children, I may.
Yeah.
So I'm just very curious about your story of so you said you were a nurse practitioner nurse practitioner for 20 years.
Not 20, about 17. What year is this?
2024.
I graduated in 2006.
Yikes.
From nursing school.
We're the same age, I think.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Why would you bring that up?
The people want to know. The people want to know.
No one wants to know how old I am except you.
So in that, was there a time when you were nursing where you were like, I just like to be around dead people and figure out why they died? Like, what led you to like, this is what I want to do?
So I met a deputy coroner when I was in nursing school. And when I met her, I asked her a million questions, right, and I got on her nerves. And I said, one day I'm going to do that. So I set a goal in 2006, and 14 years later, I put all of the goals and different things that I had in mind for that, I put them into action, and we won. Wow. I mean, I was pretty surprised. I'm a first-time candidate, no idea what I'm doing, a team of two. And it was pretty cool to go through that process. But that's how I got here. I always wanted to be able to help people in a different capacity. I worked, you know, in advocacy work while I was a nurse. I've always been the person who's willing to stand up against the system and say, hey, can we try to do this better? Or this right. patient doesn't understand this. Why is it that this patient was given insulin, but no one sat down to teach them how to administer the drug? Did you talk about side effects? So I've always been kind of that voice in healthcare that says, I don't agree with that, and can we try something different? And when I would see, as an ER nurse, when I would see patients die, their families mm-hmm. were so confused about the next steps. Yeah. And I just always thought that was so crazy, because isn't the coroner's office supposed to explain what happens? Isn't someone supposed to empower them with information so that not necessarily make the death easier, but to just give them information so that they at least know what's about to happen? And that always really bothered me, that it seemed that families were so unprepared. But outside of just the death, why don't they know this information ahead of time?
Right.
Like, what are we doing as a community,
right,
as the coroner's office, to say, hey, if you have a loved one that dies at home, do you know that you should call 911 first? A lot of people don't know that.
Right.
Or if someone overdoses in front of you, don't try to bury them in your backyard. Right. Just call 911.
Right.
That was a real case here.
No way.
Yes way.
They're like, I don't know what to do. Let me just dispose of this.
Right. And now you look suspicious, like right. you murdered this person when it was just a simple overdose. So my aim, through a little bit of dark humor sometimes, is to just try to empower the community. And that's my entire objective when I ran, even now. I've got 4 more years. I'm unopposed. I'm excited about that. So clearly something I'm doing is working. And no, there's not a line of people signing up to do this job.
Right.
but I think I do it in a way that's relatable. I think that's the biggest compliment I've ever received, is that, man, I never knew what the coroner's office did until you came into office. Like, that's pretty cool.
Sure.
Yes. I'd never heard about what a coroner is until I think you started probably talking about it in 2020. And really, I didn't know much about the school board. I didn't know much about anything prior to 2020. And then I found out in a big hurry there was a lot of different government departments that make a lot of decisions.
Yes.
And then what specifically are you responsible for or not responsible for outside of, I know there's the police investigation and then the cause of death, but the PR stuff with the family, lawyers, funeral stuff, what does that look like on your end?
All of it.
Really?
Like, we helped, first of all, we guide the family through, like, what are the next steps? What are you supposed to do? And then we get the funeral home information. If we have to hold the body, then we will, because once it goes to the funeral home, there's a fee that's incurred. So we'll hold the body, for especially for unexpected deaths, because they don't realize that the fees start as soon as they come and pick up your loved one. So sometimes we will hold the body until the family can get up enough money to be able to send them to the funeral home, so that there's not this long storage, you know, fee and process and time and all of those things. And so we do that part. And then in terms of explaining to families, once we get all of the reports back, so we order all of the tests, order all of the reports, and even law enforcement has to wait on us to do those things before they can move forward with certain things. And then sometimes the police don't know that a crime has occurred, because it may look like a natural death. So when you have old Betty Widow over here who spiked her husband's coffee with, you know, eye drops,
right,
it looks like a sweet little old lady who lost her long, you know, term lover and husband, but really you killed him. And so we help to sometimes bring information to the police. So there are different things that happen depending on the case.
It's like a CSI movie or
it is.
Show. Is that a true case that somebody used eye drops to spike it? I wouldn't have known that eye drops are that bad for him.
Yes. So there is an active ingredient in a very well-known, I won't say the name of the eye drop company, but all of us refer to eye drops as this particular brand most of the time. And if you give a person enough of that, you can actually poison their system.
Wow.
Yes.
And the oxygen cord around the neck between the dresser, is that a true one too?
That is a true one, actually. It ended up being an accident.
Really?
Yes. They just kind of stumbled.
Yes, they were trying to go to the bathroom, and they stumbled, and the cord just got wrapped up.
Wrapped around. Wow.
Have you seen anything that surprised you, where you were like, "This is didn't like"? I mean, that sounds like one of those things.
All that
like,
stuff. Oh, wow.
We have a lot of surprising cases in Richland County. Like, there is so much stuff that doesn't make the news, and every day I'm like, really? Like, how does this case not make the news? I mean, you see the ones, like we just had one where a young lady was found in a trash can. Like, okay, like that made the news. There was news media out there. But then you have just really weird cases where, you know, people are ejected from a car and there may be a bullet hole in their head. And you're like, wait a minute. You were ejected. But where did this bullet come from? Was someone else in the car? Like, what else happened here? So there's so many just weird little cases that we get where we're like, wait a minute, we got a brown paper bag, this thing, like put it all on a whiteboard, like go around the room, what happened here, what's the timeline, what are the injuries, who was all involved, you know, and then we try to determine what happened based on those things. But it gets pretty wild in there.
Wow. I love a whiteboard.
I knew that you were going to get so excited about the whiteboard.
So
I
know.
I want a whole
board.
Wall. Yeah, I want to just have
me
a wall.
Too.
Yeah, they make the wallpaper, which is cool.
Really?
Yeah.
I need this in my life.
That's nice.
Okay. Let's stay focused.
And there's massive ones that are all digital now too, but they're so expensive, but they're cool.
I like the feel of the pen on the board.
Yes.
Yeah.
But it's like the Remarkable too that I have. You have the same feeling as writing on paper, and it looks the same.
It's amazing. I want Remarkable to give me money to be their ambassador because I love that thing.
All right. We'll send this out to them.
Please
let them
do.
Know. There's no reason for them not to.
Like, why wouldn't they?
Right.
Jeez. Yeah. Give me some money, Remarkable. I love you. I love you, Remarkable.
We'll show them on the news. No, so what does your schedule look like? Because I feel like there's no days off. There's deaths every day. Do you have to be a part of every single person that dies in Richland County?
In some capacity. So all of those cases cross my desk. We have an average of 4,000 cases a year, and I'm going to touch that case at some point.
So 4,000 deaths in Richland County per year. Okay, wow.
Yes, it's a lot. So at some point, I'm signing off, reviewing quality assurance, something. I'm going to touch each of those 4,000 cases.
Dang.
Yes, it is a lot of work. So I wake up around 3 a.m. and I review cases.
You're really up at 3 a.m.?
Yes, full face, hair, makeup done, ready to go. It's weird, I know. Just, I'd like to wake up early. It's the one time of
day. That's like the middle of the night.
That is
so early.
Well, I'll tell you, it's the one time of day no one's calling.
Yep.
Yeah.
No one's bothering you. No one's posting on social media, really, unless you're Beyonce. And because I feel like she and I are kindred spirits. She doesn't sleep just like me. And you're just focused. And so if I need to write something or read something that's really, like, heavy, that's the time of morning that I do it because that's when my mind is the most clear. Now around 3 o'clock in the afternoon, I could be talking to you about, you know, nail polish colors and sound like a complete and total airhead. But at 3 a.m., I am sharp, honey, okay?
Yeah.
But no, I wake up really early so that I can review the cases. I do any schoolwork that I have because I'm in a doctoral program. And then I am a mommy. I take my children to school and make breakfast and do those things. And then I go into the office or if I have appearances or things that I have to do in the community, I do those things. And it really is nonstop. It's 24/7, 365, all holidays and weekends, baby. We're like Waffle House, just open. It's
crazy.
A lot.
It's wild.
But I love it. I love every second of it.
But how do you plan a vacation? Like, say you want to go to the Bahamas for a week.
You don't. No. I do. I take time off when I can. The summer months are the busier months because people love warm weather, and they like to say
fireworks in South Carolina.
Yeah, but they also like to do things like watch this, hold my beer.
Right.
And so you get a lot of, you know, traffic fatalities, waterway deaths, people playing around with, you know, firearms, and just families just doing crazy things together sometimes. Sometimes families do drugs together, and that's always not so fun when you go in and you've got a dad and a daughter dead. So that can be kind of crazy. So I try not to go places during the summer. If I vacation, it's either early spring or in the winter months, usually around Christmas time I may do something. But I try not to be away for a long period of time in the summer because it really is nuts here.
Right.
So out of the 4,000 people that die, there's probably 3,000 that are... They were in hospice. They died of old age.
No.
It's from a nursing home.
Way less than that.
Well, we have a large number of natural deaths here. Okay. But we have a lot of things that are, I won't say like fully preventable, but there's lots of heart disease, lots of diabetes, lots of just like poor health choices. The number of alcoholic deaths that we have is astounding to me. And the number of drug overdose deaths. Obviously, most of us see the gun violence deaths because they're reported on. But we get a lot of foolishness in this county. We also have a large number of suicides.
I was wondering about suicide.
Like 2022, there were 39 suicides. In 2023, there were 71.
Wow.
So why that number like almost doubled, I'm not quite sure. I made a video about it on my social media the other day just to try to make people aware. We don't think about the elderly and how they just get lonely and sad and they don't want to be a burden. And I think those are, now that will make me cry. The number of them that leave a note that says, I was diagnosed with cancer or I'm going blind and I don't want to be a burden on my wife or my children. And they will just kill themselves. And it just makes me so incredibly sad. Or people who are estranged from their families and don't know how to reconnect. I tell people all the time, death is random. Say the things you want to say, even if it's cussing somebody out. Go ahead and get it off of your chest. Realign yourself with your loved ones if you can. But if you can't, at least you will have peace when they die that you've done all the things that you can do, you know?
So, I mean,
deep.
Well, I saw this thing.
I feel like I'm making you guys speechless.
I'm getting emotional over here. No, I saw this thing.
Well, I was thinking about cussing someone out.
Well,
does anyone take that advice? Before you die, just make sure you let them know.
No, seriously, let them know so that you have peace within yourselves. Right. Because when they're gone, you can never say that to them. So go ahead and cuss them out now. Cuss them out today.
Well, I saw this thing on Instagram. It was like a guy telling a story about... he was basically like, I got in a fight with my wife and was feeling bad about it and was talking to his coworker and was like, yeah, when I get home, I'm gonna apologize. And the coworker was like, who told you that? It was like, who told you to apologize? Was what he was thinking. But the guy was really saying like, who told you you're gonna make it home tonight? Call her now.
Yeah.
And it was like one of those things. This morning I got in a car accident. And I almost met you in a different way. It feels like. And so it was one of those, like when you were saying that, it just made me think like, yeah, like there was no, there's just, you just don't know. And you want to make sure your daily life, you're saying what you need to say.
Every day I think about this when I wake up, death is random.
Yeah.
So what is the legacy I want to leave today? What is the level of gratitude I want to show people today? I don't leave things in a bad way. I talk to people. I have the hard conversations. And whether it's received well or not, I do my part so that every single day when I close my eyes, I know that I don't have anything that's outstanding. If they chose not to listen to me, that's their prerogative. They can do that. But at least I have peace in my heart, mind, and soul that every single day that I walk the walk and I talk the talk and I really follow this mantra of there's never a reason to be rude, unkind, or ungrateful. And that's how I live my life. So if in everything that I do, I come into it with that kind of feeling, then I know that I'm at peace when I go to bed at night.
We're really in the health space for trying to prevent people from dying and trying to get them to a prevention point where they're eating different and they're exercising different and they're doing lifestyle things where they have to take less medication and have less chronic disease. but I feel like it's an uphill battle in a lot of ways, because just there's ways that people have been used to eating for so long, or the idea that they exercise, they don't know where to start, or their parents didn't do it, or just drinking less or smoke. I feel like smoking is probably the one that's decreased the most.
Yes.
Because anywhere I go, I don't really see anybody smoking anymore.
Don't worry, they're drinking their calories.
Are they drinking instead? Is that and how? When you see someone that has a drinking death, you see cirrhosis of their liver. What else is? Is it from drinking too much and then passing out? Is it from their liver failing? Is it from getting in an accident?
All the things.
All of it.
All the things. So people don't realize that you can have alcohol toxicity, and one of the most common things I hear from the living is them saying, well, he drank all the time. Well, honey, eventually it's going to catch up with him. It's just like people saying, well, he only did the cocaine. He only did a little bit of cocaine.
Right.
Well, no amount of cocaine is safe. So when you do it and your blood pressure rises and you bust a blood vessel in your brain, you know, that's a choice that this person made. And however you feel about the drug use, we get families that say, well, it's the drug dealer's fault. But your loved one bought the drugs from them. They weren't coerced into doing that. They do it because they have the disease of addiction. And so I think more conversations need to be had around the dinner table with our friends, with our loved ones, about some of the riskier life choices that they make, just so that they have the information. I always feel that people will make better decisions when they're informed. And if they choose not to, then it's their prerogative. And you just got to accept the death of that person because they chose to do these things.
Although I feel like everybody knows that McDonald's is killing you. Everybody knows
McDonald's fries, and I will not take part in the slander of McDonald's fries.
Exactly. I mean, we might have to have a sit down then and talk about how toxic they are. Because even Coca-Cola, like, that's killing people.
It is.
Pepsi's killing people. Gatorade with blue dye and yellow dye and full of sugar and chemicals is killing people. But I don't think anybody's thinking long term about diabetes is going to catch up with me, or the way that it affects my weight is going to catch up with me at some point.
Exactly.
But you get to see them on the other side of that.
Yes, I do.
Of 20 or 30 years worth of decision after decision after decision, and then it catches up with them.
Well, if I may be the devil's advocate here,
yeah,
I have people who are the healthiest people that you could ever meet. Mm-hmm. Who run and exercise and they watch what they eat and they're 45 years old and drop dead. Mm-hmm. I have people who smoke and drink and they're 90 years old and they're still, you know, kicking. So I think you have to do what's best for your body. And I'm not here to judge anyone. And although I want people to make healthier decisions, what I realize is that we have free will. And just give them the information. Mm-hmm. Some people will change their lives by changing their health, and they will change the trajectory of their life by doing so. Mm-hmm. And then you have people who will say, I'm eating the bacon cheeseburger from McDonald's every day with a side of fries and a hot apple pie. Yep. And you just got to say, okay.
That's their decision.
And if you do that, here are the side effects or the potential side effects of doing that. And at least they know. So I'm of the mindset that you give people the information, you reiterate the information, and then let them make their decisions and then help manage it when it all goes bad. Yep.
Yeah.
Or they're just in my morgue.
And I agree with that too. There's for sure a genetic component to a lot of things that some people just, there's no controlling it no matter what. Right. There's some people who are more genetically susceptible to it.
Yes.
And then there's some people who, it just, their body doesn't adapt as well to their environment. So two people could eat the exact same things.
Yes.
One of them gets heart disease, one of them doesn't.
Exactly.
And we talk about that a lot too. How do you get your body to regulate, to adapt to your body? We always talk about like the brain and the spinal cord and the nerve system. We're obviously really focused on the nervous system as chiropractors.
Yes.
But it's tough probably to see two people that make the same decisions and one of them, it ends up on your table, and one of them lives to be 94 years old.
It is. And I think the harder conversations are people who are known to have riskier behaviors, and then no one can just believe that they actually died from this thing that they've been doing so long.
Yes.
Like, well, my dad's been drinking since I was a little kid. Well, honey, eventually the cirrhosis of the liver is going to take dad out. eventually the crack cocaine use is going to take, you know, your loved one out, like there are consequences to the decisions that we make. And so at some point it's going to catch up with your body because it just can't handle it. So it's a hard thing to have these conversations, mm-hmm. but I always try to think that this is someone's loved one and all they really want to know is, did they suffer? You know, do I think they're going to be okay? I try not to get into conversations about spirituality or religion, yeah. but I just tell them, you know, whatever you believe, just believe the best thing. If this person, you know, lived a beautiful life and you believe that, you know, there's a heaven or hell or whatever it is, then I pray that they're in the space that you want them to be in. And then we get people who are not so upstanding members of society and their families are like, you know, they can go to hell. And we're like, okay.
Oh, geez.
Oh, sure. Goodness.
We've had people tell us, don't call us about that man again because he was, you know, the devil himself. And we're like, oh, okay. Well, dang. So sorry for your loss. Mm.
They're rejoicing over there with their loss.
No, seriously. We've had people like, you can keep him. We're not coming to get him.
Really?
Yes.
What do you do with that?
We do a community burial and put them in the ground.
Seriously? I didn't know that.
Yes, you can you can not claim your deceased family member or loved one. We don't want you to do that, though. Please
right.
don't do that. It
right.
hurts the taxpayers, y'all.
That's what I was going to say. Who pays for that? Us.
The county pays for it.
Okay.
Good old Popper's funeral.
So is when you're looking at overall health, life, death of our county versus, say, other counties across the country, what do you see?
Bad, bad, bad. We have one of the highest diabetes and amputation rates per capita in the country.
I've heard that we're the below-the-knee amputee capital of the entire country,
no,
Columbia.
Seriously. There was a whole article on this, and I want to tell you the name of the journal source. It's escaping me right now, but I want to say maybe like orthopedic surgery or something like that. But we have such a large number of persons who end up with an amputation that orthopedic surgeons come here to train. And I think that is incredibly sad, and I think it's pretty irresponsible of the healthcare system that we have access to here, mm-hmm. because people with diabetes should have access to the most advanced modalities before you disable these people for the rest of
right.
their lives.
Mm-hmm.
And to know that within 5 years of them having an amputation, their death rate goes up significantly
right.
is even more troubling.
Yep.
So I was a wound nurse. I saw lots of people with diabetes, lots of wounds. And when I talk about advocacy, this is what I'm talking about. So as a nurse, I would see people with diabetes who would have, you know, foot wounds and leg wounds. And I would say, well, have you been to see the vascular surgeon? Have they done, you know, studies to see whether or not you've got good blood flow to this area before they debride your leg
right.
or foot or whatever it is? And they would say, well, no one sent me there. Well, you need to ask. And so at the coroner's office, we have an Ask a Doctor program, and we bring a physician or a doctorally trained medical professional into the community. We meet people where they are, and they have the opportunity to ask questions that they may not feel comfortable asking in the 10-minute time frame that
right.
they have to see you in the clinic. And so we brought a cardiologist. We've brought someone who specializes in like sleep medicine, mm-hmm. who can talk to you about why you actually need to wear your CPAP machine. We've talked about the effect of diabetes and child abuse and all of those different things, so that when you go to the doctor, you are armed with information, you're armed with questions that you can ask on your behalf to advocate for yourself. If you're a diabetic and you have a foot wound, no one should be cutting on that wound until you've had some sort of vascular study to determine the blood flow to the area, because if it's poor, your wound will never heal.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So why would you cut on me knowing that my chances of healing are so slim? So I do lots of work, and we try to put it all on social media, but there's so much stuff that I do behind the scenes that doesn't even make it to social media, because I want people to be armed with information. Like, why would you disable someone without giving them a chance to at least heal first, or to help them understand that the insulin that they're on may make them gain weight? why wouldn't you try to put them in a program? Why don't we as a community demand more from our insurance companies?
Right.
There are programs. There's a program called Rewind. It can literally reverse diabetes so that you're not on insulin or taking medications. Why aren't the insurance companies promoting that to the people with diabetes
right.
and hypertension? Like,
well, I think it's
don't get me started, y'all.
I think it's because they're bought and paid for yeah. by the big pharma.
Well, yeah. I didn't say that, y'all did.
I'm saying that openly. And in fact, I think everybody agrees with it. I don't know why people don't say it more often. It's most of the time insurance companies are not doing what's best for the patient. They're doing what's best for their shareholders. Yes. And they're kind of doing what big pharma tells them that they should do. And even in the medical world, I think a lot of medical doctors know other ways, or they want to know other ways of doing things, but you're just trained to do drug surgery. So the idea of looking into different programs is just outside of their training. And even for us, honestly, we have a class 4 Sumas medical laser that we've been, and it's been shown to help people with neuropathy. So they can't feel their feet, can't feel their legs, which are at really high risk of having their foot or leg amputated.
Yes.
And it works amazing. We've had testimonials in here. We've had people like, it's the first time I can feel the gas pedal, first time I can put my sandals on, first time I can feel the dirt on the floor when I'm walking around.
Which is really important for people who have diabetes and lack that feeling.
Right. Huge. And they have no idea about it.
Yes.
Exactly. It's like 80-90% recovery.
I love this.
Which is nuts. We were sitting in a seminar and the same stats that you were saying about the 5-year amputation thing, we were like, what? Because they were teaching this, and it was like, how does not everybody know about this laser that is, it's the easiest thing these people can do, because you just show up and let somebody run a laser on you.
Right. But the information isn't out there. So I think podcasts like this, the way you utilize your social media can be really, really informative. But will they see it? What I most often see is the people we're really trying to reach don't have social
They don't
media.
See it. And insurance doesn't cover
it doesn't.
That. So the problem that we're running into is the people who need it most are the ones who can't work because they have neuropathy or they have all these health issues. They're the ones that need it the most, but they're also the ones that can't pay for it.
Exactly.
And we're running into the issue of, well, we need our staff won't come in and do it all for free. So we have to figure out, how do we bridge that gap and get to those people?
Yeah.
I agree. It's very frustrating to be on both sides, to be on the healthcare side and know that people need help and that there are resources out there, but you can't utilize them because they're cost prohibitive for the patient. So it's a very frustrating world to be in at times, but I try to advocate on social media to show people that, like, even if your grandmother doesn't have Facebook or Instagram, you as the granddaughter do, and you can go with her to the doctor and you can advocate for her. Here are some questions that you can ask.
Yep.
Yes.
And it really does work. I've had so many people reach out to me and say, hey, remember those 20 questions you gave me about hypertension? I like circled 5 of them and I made the doctor answer them. Now my grandmother is taking her medicine. They took her off of these medications because we were able to ask more informed questions. And it's really, really helpful. So we're not going to reach everyone, but we can reach some people.
Yeah.
That's my life philosophy, is that people should ask more questions.
Yes.
My wife, it's actually Tom and my wife barely want to go places with me because I ask so many questions. But usually, and it's even if it's at a school meeting or in a medical setting or at seminars especially, I ask 50 questions. Nobody else asks any.
Yes, and they want to know.
And then the instructor's sitting there like, any more questions except for you? And hundreds of people won't ask a question. And then I'd be like, all right, what's yours? Go ahead. But then they all come up to me afterwards and they're like, oh, thanks. I was wondering about that. I was wondering about that. The instructor will say something that makes no sense. And I'll be the only person to say, I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
But I feel like in the medical setting, a lot of people do that too, because sometimes I'm even sitting with the patient and I'm like, you're not asking me the question. Like, either you just trust me too much or you're not asking me the questions that you should be asking me.
Well, I think that it depends on where you come from and your life experiences. In the Black community, there's a lot of distrust of the healthcare system. Mm-hmm. And we are trained from the time that we're little kids, and I'm not telling you how old I am, so don't even.
Oh, I know.
But there's this just kind of innate mistrust and it's passed down generation to generation. Okay. Because you have the history of things like the Tuskegee syphilis study that are still impacting the healthcare of African Americans today. Mm-hmm. Or you go to the doctor and the person doesn't look like you. And I don't care mm-hmm. what your beliefs are, representation matters. And your ability to connect with people matters. So as a nurse, nurse practitioner, as the coroner, sometimes people tell me things just because I can relate to them in a different way. And I think all of us are that way. I think it transcends race, religion, culture. It's just a thing. If I can relate to you, then I'm more comfortable with you. So when we have like Spanish-speaking families, just being able to speak a small amount of Spanish to say, you know, no te preocupe, just to say like, don't worry about this part, like I'm going to take care of you, that means something to them. And I wish I could, you know, I'm working on trying to speak, you know, more languages so that I can understand. Yeah, I really am trying to learn just little phrases that may mean something to them, because it matters. Just being able to relate in some way to show that I don't care what you believe, to be able to reach across and pat someone's hand or just to make them feel like you care about them and their loved one, it really does matter.
Nice. Now take us back to day one. When you're taking over this after a long period of time of, you know, nobody really, there's no classes. I'm sure there wasn't much organization when you took it over. Like, what
it's
did
the
that,
middle of COVID?
Yeah, like what did this look like?
There was no transition. Yeah. As a matter of fact, I won the election in June of 2020, and you take office the first Tuesday of the January after you win the election. Okay. So you don't take office until like the next year, people don't realize. I don't even think I realized that. So there were no manuals on how to do things. There was really nothing left for us in the office. And I think the first quarter I slept there almost every day. I had an entirely new team. There were less than 10 people left from the previous administration. So where there had been 41 employees, there were like less than 10. Wow. And we had to cover a county that's almost 420,000 people. And I've already told you the average number of deaths per year. Yes. So it was a lot. And I just relied heavily on my nursing background, being able to triage and prioritize. And then I went to work on my objectives. My very first goal was to take care of the people mm-hmm. that were there. They did not receive overtime pay prior to me coming in. If you were a full-time employee, you did not receive overtime pay. So you could work 200 hours or you could work 40 hours. Your pay was the same. And I think that's crazy being a first responder. They didn't have like holiday benefits. There was no like, There just seemed to be no pay structure that was appropriate for the type of on-call work that they were doing. So for the first 11 months, I literally just went to bat for my people, like to the point where I was like, I'm willing to boycott if we don't get fair pay. And my team, I think they thought I was nuts. You know, initially they were like, we can't boycott. I said, well, then let them pick up the bodies if they're not willing to pay our staff. And they sat down and they said, we don't have to go to those extremes. Right. But I said, well, let's look at federal labor laws and let's see if the county is in alignment with these things. And they were very gracious and said, okay, what is it that you want for your team? So I think the biggest part of my first year was taking care of our team. And when you take care of your people, they will take care of you. Mm-hmm. So year two was pretty simple, because we had taken care of our people in the first year, and then we started doing our community stuff. And it's just all, you know, in alignment now. It's pretty nice.
Great.
I can come and do things like this during the
day. That's fun, yeah.
And then how'd you know what to dress like? Like, you're very well dressed, and
thank you.
Like, I would have felt like you'd go black yoga pants, black t-shirt every day.
Okay, so...
Like that.
Let me tell you, prior to being the coroner, and even though I'm a nurse practitioner, nationally board certified and all the things, I had a styling business. So I've always been really into fashion.
Yes. Okay, that makes more sense.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and I believe in being well-dressed. So I grew up as a ward of the state. I was a foster kid. all of my clothing was secondhand until I was a very grown adult and got my first job. And so being well-dressed is, I think, a trauma response in a lot of ways, but I never, ever, ever go anywhere without being dressed nicely. Mm-hmm. It's like my one self-care, non-negotiable, I don't play that. I must be well-dressed at all yeah. times. Like my uniform, my uniform is tailored to me. So like if I need to nip in the shirt lines, if I need to adjust the pants,
you everything. Get it customized.
I do. Even wow. when I was a nurse, though, and I worked in the ER, one of the physicians said, "Do you get your scrubs tailored?" I said, "Oh, yes, sir, I do." And he was like, "Why? You're just going to get blood right, and guts right. all over them." And I said, "Because I believe that the way you dress is your language to the world."
Right.
And I want to dress the way I want to be addressed. It's very hard to disrespect a well-dressed person.
Good point.
So even as a nurse, I feel like the nurses that come in and they look like they just rolled out of bed, their scrubs are nasty, or they're wrinkled, their shoes are dirty. I feel like they don't pay attention to details.
Right.
And so for me, and the way that I was trained as a nurse, you pay attention to yourself first so that when you walk into that room, you're walking in giving that person the best version of you that you can. Imagine you're going through the worst time of your life. And I believe this as the coroner. I'm showing up to your door, 3 a.m., looking like I just rolled out of bed. I think you want me to look like I've been working on your loved one's case.
Right.
I think you want me to look like I know what I'm talking about, that I'm not disheveled and looking rushed in my appearance. I'm well put together because I have a well put together life. I'm well put together because I pay attention to the details. I pay attention to all of the things that I think go into a death investigation, and I do that in my daily life. So every morning that I wake up, my hair's done, my makeup's done, and I can walk out of the house every day ready to go on any scene, any situation, and I look professional. But this is well before I became the coroner. I love fashion. I think there's a place for it even in what I'm doing now. I think people should dress appropriately. I
yeah.
hate when I see people show up and they look disheveled.
Right.
I won't trust you if that's how you look.
Mm-hmm.
You didn't care enough about yourself to look like you even put a comb through your hair. Like, I don't want you taking care of me.
Right.
Yep. So I'm really particular about that.
What about,
I like that.
You want me to ask her about guys' fashion now?
Yeah, that was my lead in for you to ask her about men's fashion.
Which I'm always very interested in.
Okay.
Not because I necessarily want to be super fashionable, but I just don't want to make the mistakes that I know that I generally make.
You know what I tell people? It doesn't matter what gender you identify as. Learn what works for you. And if dressing is not your forte, if you're not into fashion, you don't want to be adventurous with your looks, then you should have a uniform. And your uniform doesn't necessarily have to be scrubs, but if you wear scrubs, make sure that they fit you well. Make
yeah.
sure you get them tailored. Spend the money for the more expensive line so that they fall better. If you are going to wear jeans and a t-shirt, learn what t-shirt looks right for your
right.
body type. So you may be a guy, maybe you've got a bigger midsection. Go for the t-shirt that has a little more room in the body, but tighter on the arms. It's going to make you look more fit. If you
That's
are...
Randall, right?
What about a V-neck? Do you think a V-neck helps?
I think your V-neck is fine.
Yeah, all right.
I think the shorter you are, V-neck gives you a little bit more skin to show so that you look taller.
Yeah, that's good.
Oh,
elongates
nice.
The neck. Yeah. So there
you
are some...
You needed that tip.
There you
yeah.
go. You V-neck them down, baby.
I've always been into V-necks since probably 2007.
Yeah, but have a uniform. Like, if you know that you like to wear black tees, buy 7 black tees.
I don't know why
it's
so
because he was
because I've
one time my very first time yeah he was there. It was 2007. I was in Orlando trying to go into, I think it was Cowboys. It was like a kind of a country like
okay.
line dancing place, and I was like, oh, I'm so nervous wearing a V-neck because it felt
why?
Like it just felt a little more feminine.
No.
It felt like it looked more feminine than I was
you
used
look buff
to.
in your V-neck tee, so
thank you.
Own that and just use it to your advantage.
And well, now I love it. I just had to get comfortable with
yeah.
myself. But they wouldn't let me in because it was just something.
They had a dress
it.
Code.
Yeah,
wow.
dress
you
code.
Couldn't wear a plain white t-shirt, I think it was.
Yes.
They
oh, yeah,
didn't
that's
want
what it
you
was.
Showing cleavage, maybe?
Yeah, it was his. No,
I don't know. I looked too good. They were just...
Oh my gosh, this podcast is taking a turn.
Well, here's another
it
one.
It stayed serious for way longer than normal.
I think he is here to break all of the seriousness down. I love it.
So, I mean, I was curious about this, on how has this role affected personal life? Like, what are your dreams like? What are your relationships like? What is friendships like with you?
So I am a very giving person. Like, if I rock with you, you have all access to my life, to me, and that's just how I am. But my circle is very small. You will see me with the same, like, 4 to 5 people all the time. Yeah. It doesn't change. There's no deviation. Because when I want to let my hair down, I want to trust that the people around me will have my best interest at heart. So if I want to sing and dance in my backyard, I want to know that someone doesn't have their phone up like, oh, gosh, look what the coroner's doing.
Yeah.
So I'm very, very, very private, not secretive, private.
Sure.
I don't live a, you know, secretive life. I mean, you see me on social media, pretty much what you see is what you get. I listen to everything from gospel to trap music. So if you see me in my car, you know,
yeah,
singing hallelujah or singing Nuck If You Buck, like, just be prepared. I've already told you. So I'm very much a fun person. Like, I love to laugh. Any chance I get to do that, I do. But I'm really around the same, like, 4 to 5 people. But I'm a homebody. Like, I'm not a person who needs to be, like, on the scene. People may think that because my social media makes it seem like I'm so, like, extroverted. But really, I'm extroverted when I need to be. Most of the time, I'm at home. I'm chilling. Still with my hair and makeup done. Let's be very clear about that. And you may see me in a sequin gown. Don't worry about that. That's just how I felt that day. But so I like
just
to wear costumes.
Watering your flowers outside in a sequin gown.
No, but really. Really. That's exactly what's happening. I may go to the grocery store in that, you don't know. Yeah. But I love fashion, so when I'm not working, I'm creating. Yeah. I upcycle clothing. I paint. I love a good DIY project around the house. So my life is actually really calm and peaceful and beautiful because death makes you realize how much you want to live.
Right.
And so every opportunity that I get to laugh, eat a good steak, you know, have some good food. I love to cook. I just hang out. Me and my boys, like, I took the boys to the soccer game yesterday in Charlotte. And we're just sitting out there in the rain and the cold, just cheering on the team that lost by 3 points, but whatever. Nice. But we have a good time. And I don't try to, you know, be something that I'm not. And I think, you know, people see that when they're around me. I'm just a homegirl. Like, I'm just a homebody. I'm country. I probably don't have shoes on if you come to my house. Like, I really am in my yard in my gown, watering my decrepit roses, but they're mine, damn it. And so I don't know. I'm pretty chill.
Yeah.
Yep.
Except when I get dressed. I'm very extra when I get dressed all the time.
Yeah.
Like, it's always foolish.
So can you, like, would you get drunk? Would you drink to the point where you're tipsy? Because you could get a phone call at any moment, right?
Right. So no, that is not my life. Sorry.
Not into it.
Nope. Okay. Nope. And I'll tell you, in 2020, I had a really scary situation happen. I won't go into the details of it, but I believe someone spiked my drink.
Ooh.
And I was very nervous about that because I'm not a heavy drinker. I may take a shot every now and again. I love tequila. I like Crown, you know, but I'm not a heavy drinker. And so for me to be like, whoa, like, what's happening here and, like, out of it was very weird. And I really believe someone put something in my drink. But again, you know, I'm kind of in a role where I can get a call any minute. Like, every time I go out, there's, like, some call. So, like, I planned a birthday party for a friend and I said, guys, I forwarded all my calls. I'm out tonight. Got on my pretty pink dress. I'm ready.
Yep.
And then I get a call that a firefighter died in the line of duty, and I had to go home and put on my uniform and go to that scene and be right on camera as soon as I get there. So I don't really have that luxury.
Right.
When I travel, then I may, you know, have a glass of wine. I love champagne, but I'm not a get drunk kind of person.
Yep.
Nice.
Just not.
So I feel like you, and you said earlier, you're the first female coroner,
yes,
first African-American coroner, first coroner with medical experience.
Yes.
So I mean, you're in an
you're in the history books at this point.
Yeah, I am a legend.
What is that like walking in there and bringing a different perspective than what it's used to? Do you feel like your people are open to it? Do you feel like you're kind of having to knock down walls?
I receive a lot of criticism for the way I've chosen to be the coroner. But I've also received national recognition for what I do as the coroner. Mm-hmm. So to the haters, I say judge your mama and don't worry about what I'm doing over here. And to the
Go judge your mama.
I've never heard that.
I've never either, but what I like it.
Yeah.
Judge your mama.
Yeah.
Like whatever limitations or judgments that you're placing on me, go give that to your mom.
Your mom.
Yeah,
that's
let
good.
Her carry that for you.
Oh, I'm going to use that too. Yeah. That's great.
You're welcome. But for the people who are in support of the way that I'm doing things, you can tell that those people have never seen it done this way. It's innovative, it's fresh, it's different. And I love being able to bring all of me, my feminine self, my black girl magic self, my medical self. I love being able to bring all of that into this space because it's never been done. And when you think about the questions that you all, I mean, we spent the majority of this podcast talking about my role as coroner, right? Mm-hmm. Because people don't know, and my job is to tell them. And I have chosen to do it in a different way than other people have before me. And I'm not going to apologize for authenticity. Like, what? We live in a world full of so much made-up mm-hmm. stuff. I'm going to be authentically me. And if I step on a few toes doing that, if I need to apologize, I will. But I'm not going to ever apologize for being my authentic self. Like, you can choke on that.
That's good.
Choke on that.
I feel like when you have haters, you're doing something.
Yeah.
Like, you almost have to have that. Mm-hmm. Even for our show, we had got zero negative reviews here.
Nice.
And I was getting a little worried, like, wait, is it just our family and friends that are just like pumping us up? And then we got one and I was like, all right, now we're now you're kind of in it when you start hearing both sides, the good and the bad, both sides.
Well, I think the goal is to disrupt the system. And the only way to do that is by doing something different than what the system is accustomed to. So if me making videos about kids not getting drunk on prom night upsets you, oh, boo-hoo, go cry to your mama, because that is not my concern. And I think that I just follow this philosophy that, like, talk less, do more. I'm doing the work that I said I was going to do. I've accomplished all of the goals that I've set for myself. He asked the question about how does this affect my life. It makes me dream so big. You guys, you know, obviously promote health and wellness. In 2022, I had to have a double mastectomy because of a mammogram that was bad, and I got the diagnosis. And I've always been a workaholic. I've always been somebody who just, like, I mean, when you grow up the way that I did, poor, homeless, all the things, like, you're like, no, really, I have to work. I don't have the luxury of not figuring it out, right? But now I'm like, I also want to live. And I promised myself that when I got up out of that bed, that when I could, that I would live the best possible life that I could live, because I knew what it was like to feel desperate and to feel despair and to feel like you wanted to die. And so now I'm like, you're going to take all of colorful Nada, and I don't really care what you feel about that. I'm going to be my authentic self, whether you like it or not. And then I just want to be a good example for my boys. I want them to see their mom and say, she lived a good life. She took care of us. We had fun. We have great memories. And she was present. You know what I mean?
Yep.
So I have a really amazing life. I'm so happy.
Yeah.
And you've been through some stuff.
Yeah, I have.
Yeah.
I've earned this. Like,
that's true.
When people
you didn't get here by accident.
That's right.
Honey, hell no. I have earned the life that I live. So if I'm wearing nice shoes and a nice suit, please don't bother me, because I bought that and I paid for that.
Yep.
Through blood, sweat, and tears, I've gotten to this point to be able to afford the life that I have, and I'm very grateful.
Yep. How pissed off do you get when people call you Nadia? And how
very
often
pissed.
Does it happen?
Every day. And it doesn't matter how many times I say my name is Nada. It's two syllables. And if you can't get it right, then just call me Mrs. Rutherford. And if you can't get that right, then you can call me Madam Coroner.
That's good. For the record, I said your name right. I just spelled it wrong. Okay, but good. Accident. I didn't mean to.
Best part is it's literally right
there. I know. Well, I didn't want to be looking overhead when I was saying it, but I should have.
We forgive you. But I will correct you every single time.
Yeah. Yes.
Madam Coroner has a nice ring to it. Do you get that a lot?
Yes, I do. It's actually like the, you know how they say like the honorable? So Madam Coroner is actually the proper way to address
really?
Me as a female elected official as coroner. I didn't know that. I thought they were being funny, but it's actually appropriate.
The right thing.
Like Madam Vice President.
Yeah.
It's Madam Coroner.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
That's cool. Now, in your dreams, the real, like you're, when you're sleeping.
Yes.
Do you see faces and blood and like any of that? Really?
I think I'm missing the gene that you're supposed to have where you're like severely affected by death because I'm just not. Like, I don't carry it. The things that I see are, who did this? Why can't I figure out the answer? So I will wake up
sometimes. You're solving problems.
There you go. That's what I see. I don't, the gory stuff, it doesn't, I don't know why. It just doesn't bother
me. Like, were you ever growing up scary movies, any of that stuff? You were like fine watching it?
I don't watch scary movies.
Me neither.
I don't really watch TV, actually. It's weird. I'm not a TV person.
No kidding.
I read a lot.
Why not? You were not watching Bravo television?
What's on there?
You got Housewives. You got Vanderpump.
I hate all things that are like soap opera related. Like, can I gag on air? I don't do any of those.
What kind of things do you like to read? Do you like to read fiction stuff or do you like
to
read? Really?
I do. I love all the murder mysteries. Now, if I do watch anything, I'm watching like The First 48, anything that's like about a serial killer. I love like reading about serial killers, not because I want to know about their crimes, but really how were they caught and what mistakes they made and the reasoning behind them committing the crimes so that if we ever get something like that here, maybe I can pick up on it faster or notice something. So it's really kind of like research.
Sure.
Or I'm looking at something related to fashion.
Fashion, yeah.
That's my like go-to like downtime thing. Yep. It's always something fun like that.
So you must have just a massive closet with every color and every cord, everything.
Yes, I do.
How do you have time to go shopping and
figure that out?
Is it online? Is that how you do it? Because it's hard to know how something's going to fit
or look. Well, then she gets it tailored.
No. So I dress for my body type. I have an eye body type. I wrote a book about this. I actually have a book on Amazon called... Yes.
How many people know about this?
It's called The Nada Method, End Fitting Room Frustration. But it walks women through the 6 most common body types and what works for your body. And it gives you like a little worksheet and just some ideas about how to style things in your closet. It hasn't been updated in a really long time, but it's still very relevant. I still have people who are like, wait a minute, I bought your book off of Amazon, and it's like it was very helpful to me. Or my mom gave me this book as a graduation present. So I help people understand that 90% of your life is more than likely work-related with your uniform, whether it's going to be a T-shirt, blazer, you know, slacks, pair of nice shoes, whether you're going to wear a dress, like, you know, it kind of walks you through those things. And I do have a massive closet. I probably have over 300 pairs of shoes. I could probably wear a different pair of shoes every single day for a year and not repeat.
Wow.
It's ridiculous. It's consumerism at its finest. And I don't care. It's like the thing. And I may only have them on for like 5 minutes, but like I love a good shoe.
Yeah.
I do. Now, I thrift most of my clothing unless I'm getting it custom made. Like my suit today, these pants are named after me. They're called the Nada pants.
Oh.
It's a local designer. Her name is Min Lee. And
I've heard of Min Lee.
Yes, she's so amazing. She just made the suit for Camila Cardoza's WNBA draft.
Okay.
Yes. And she made this suit, y'all, without ever meeting Camila.
Really?
Yes. She like studied hours of footage on Camila. She took some measurements because she also designs for Asia Wilson.
And she's local here.
She's in Lexington.
And she does the coach of the game.
Dawn Staley?
Yes.
Yeah.
Really? So
did
the pants, the joggers, the leather joggers that Dawn wore in the game before the final, They were Min Lee.
No kidding.
Yeah, she's amazing. Like, I love her. But she does my suits because it's hard to find things when you're tall. And she just gets it, like, but she makes men's clothing. She'll make you the best suit you've ever worn in your life, the best slacks, because she measures parts that you just didn't even know someone should measure to make a suit. Like, she's amazing.
Yes.
She measures all the parts.
There was actually at the fundraiser that the McDaniels fundraiser, she it was a suit from her was on there.
Yeah, she is amazing. So if it's not Min Lee, then most of the time it's thrifted clothing. Like, I'll put on
just
a 50
cent. Just go to Goodwill and
kind of like
look
around.
Yeah,
like this top is not Min Lee. I bought this for 50 cents at the Goodwill.
Really? Yeah, I need to go there more.
And then you got to and then you have to tailor it probably.
Well, this one fit pretty well.
Oh, nice.
It's kind of old. I think someone probably made it in there. Probably a little homemade something, but it fits me like they made it for me, so it works.
That's good.
I got to get back into thrifting.
You got to get into fashion again.
Yeah.
Well, you guys
I need new shoes.
Fairly decent today.
I know. I need new shoes. I got my golf socks on. Fairly decent. We look fairly decent.
You guys are sixes.
You guys are fives.
You guys
are barely pushing average, but it's not the worst.
Yeah. I'll give you about a four. Was that supposed to be nicer?
No. Sorry. We want honesty.
Yeah.
We got to talk to our designer about that.
Yeah.
We're not wearing this because they force us to. You know? Yep. Of the 4,000 deaths, percentage-wise, what is the most common that you're seeing in Richland County? Is it auto?
No, hypertension.
Oh, really?
Hypertension, atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. It's always, it's almost always, if always it's a natural death, related to heart disease.
Gotcha.
Yep. And that's our biggest killer here.
And what's a shocking one that people wouldn't know about?
Trip and fall?
No. Shocking is, I'm not going to say that. It's too gruesome, I think, for the airwaves. I don't know. So people visit Columbia a lot, and they live a double life. And so sometimes we find people in hotel rooms with objects inserted into certain bodily orifices that they don't tell their
Randy's been
about.
There. If he's seen it once, he's seen it a million times.
My buddy that worked at the ER, he said that people were putting
gerbils.
Live gerbils.
Yeah. Champagne bottle splits, extra large phallic devices. Mm-hmm. Some of the stuff you're like, why would you even think to do that? But they do it. Autoerotic asphyxiation, those are the things that don't make the news, and we've had quite a few deaths related to that, and they're not considered suicides, they're considered accidents, because the goal is pleasure and not death.
Yeah.
But we've had quite a few of those as well.
They would be, how would you know if they're homicide versus suicide? Because they sound like homicide.
Listen, and sometimes the way we find the bodies, you have to like take a step back and say, did someone do this to them? But typically what we find is there's like a failed fail-safe. So they have something that will untie all of it if they just pull, and then it will fail.
And then it didn't, but that didn't work.
Exactly. So you can pretty much tell what looks like a homicide and what looks like they did this to themselves. And they typically have a history of doing it. If you start, interviewing people who've dated them or who've been around them. Y'all, there are some secret, like, crazy clubs here in Columbia, and you just would not believe some of the things that happen right here. These are the people you go to church with. These are people that...
Little secret society type stuff, huh?
No, seriously. We've had some cases where some of the details that are revealed, you're like, oh... Okay, goodness. And then I have to say this to someone's mom.
Oh, right.
And you're trying to spare them the details, and then all of a sudden the mom is cussing you out because she's, you're holding something back from me. Well, ma'am, I don't want to tell you that your son was found in a wig and a dress and high heel shoes.
God. With nine gerbils inside of them.
Exactly.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's a world that we don't really ever see any of that. No. We're just totally kind of blind to it. I remember even when I was so blind to any of that world that when 50 Shades of Grey became like a bestseller, I was looking around thinking, who's buying all these? Because I don't think I know anybody who would read it or have it. And then I realized, wait, it's everywhere.
Millions of people enjoy that series.
100%.
Yep.
Wow.
And they do so here in Columbia. There's several clubs.
I'm sure.
You know what I always wondered about, too? When we were in school, the thing that they taught us, too, was the leading killer in the United States was iatrogenic death, which they said was medically induced death. Meaning the cause was due to whether it was medication given improperly or surgeries that weren't necessary or whatever it was.
Allergic reactions, side effects, chronic use of NSAIDs.
Like through the roof, and nobody talked about that. They talked about like heart disease, cancer, which were what they would say were the leading killers in the U.S., but those were the disease killers.
Yes.
And a lot of those instances, they actually said were actually iatrogenic deaths based on the treatment side of it.
Well, I'll tell you this. If you have someone who has hypertension, the number of medications that they're on, they don't know to say no. They don't know to say, hey, do I need to take all of these pills? Is there an alternative? And then the side effects from the polypharmacy in our communities causes so many other chronic health conditions. So if you're a person
who has a guessing game.
Yeah, it really is.
Yes.
So I promote, you know, things like healthy living and healthy eating. Of course, people will do what they want to do, but if they have the information, maybe they change one or two things, or maybe they may not change, but maybe they do better for their children. Like I don't buy junk food at my house. My children may get that from their dad's house. But at my house, they know there's no soda here. There's no red dye. There's I don't buy those things. You eat fruit, vegetables, and I will cook.
Love that.
You know, but, you know, it's kind of one of those things where people just, they're going to do what they
want
to and do that, in a lot of ways.
That's what we were seeing when we got into practice, too, was the amount of medication was shocking when we're just taking intake forms.
It's like 20 pills.
Yes, and you're kind of like, there's not a study or doctor on the planet that knows what the hell's going on in your particular body with this concoction. Like, you are the experiment.
In your community. So one of the most eye-opening things for me as a nurse practitioner is, did you ask them about their actual home? When you're talking to them about buying fresh fruits and vegetables, do they live in a food desert? Do they have access to those things? Do they have access to a place where they can actually buy fresh items? And if they don't, what options do you have? Because you could, even if you don't provide it necessarily, could you allow local farmers to come in and they could purchase things from there? They accept certain food programs that are federally funded, They accept SNAP benefits and all of those things. Why can't doctor's offices host markets like that for people who live in food deserts? When they come for their appointment, they can at least during that 1 to 2 weeks have access to fresh fruit and vegetables. Like, I think that there are very real solutions that are very, very simple that most people don't want to do.
And there's an education side too about getting them to eat the vegetables, because they don't taste very good. Or you have to prepare them in a certain way, or you have to get used to them, or if they're not, which I think is a big issue, if they're not introduced when you're young, it's hard to start eating them when you're 18 years old or 20.
And the exposure, like, tell me, like, you live a very different life than a lot of people, right? Like, you can admit
100%.
That. Like, I didn't know what a damn butternut squash was until I was, like, in my 30s. I had never seen that. I'm being so serious. My vegetables growing up, green beans out of a can, or you have the little snap peas, black-eyed peas, lima beans, squash. I had never seen a zucchini ever in my life. So I think it's really about exposure. And the more you can expose, you know, people to things, it's like sampling stuff at the Sam's or the Walmart. You may not try it unless you get a sample. So maybe you can have healthy cooking demonstrations at the doctor's office. I just think we have to put more out there in our community that people can have access to. And realize that a lot of the people with these chronic health conditions don't have the same access that you think they do.
Butternut squash is a funny one to pick on. It's just not, my wife makes that all the time, but I didn't, I never had it until I was probably, until I got married, probably when I was 25. Didn't know what it was. I don't think they grow in Canada at all.
Well, you may not have had access to that.
But corn, but I feel like corn and soy and like some of the,
Rice.
There's like things that are being subsidized and overmade, and then sugars being added to them.
Exactly. Genetically modified.
Oh, yes. they're just loaded with pesticides. Like, I think there's this massive issue of just food, big food companies just making a lot of money getting people addicted to things and making cheaper and cheaper food.
Yeah. Well, when you have inflation, when you have the working poor, when you have people who don't have access to livable wages, you know, we could get into the politics of all of that and, you know, but we don't have to do that today.
Right.
It's going to change. So I think it's shift. I feel things are shifting towards people just getting sick of taking a ton of drugs, being sick all the time, and then being frustrated with their energy and their weight and their health because of their diet.
We have the power to change it. We have the power to change it. We just have to collectively decide that that's what we're doing. I think we had a lot of like, it's just kind of like the Walmart effect, right? Like you get rid of all of the local small businesses that are doing things that are like really farm to table kind of things. And then you bring in all of this prepackaged foods. And there's so many things that impact this, y'all, like the mom not being in the home as much because you need a two-person, you know, income household at this point. And so many of our values have shifted. But I think that dads can be responsible. Grandmothers can be responsible. Uncles, aunts. Like, I think if collectively as families, we kind of put it all together and say, hey, can we all, you know, get together for this meal that's healthier? Can we learn different ways to do this? Like, someone has to take charge at some point. And I think that we certainly see a push for that. But there are just some people who love a good pork rind and a fat bag.
Like,
I didn't know that fat bag wasn't real bacon until I was in South Carolina.
I don't even know what that is.
You don't know what fat bag is?
No.
Kind of like pork belly, but a lot fattier.
Really?
Ever had pork belly?
I feel like that would just melt. Is it just like melty? What is it?
It is gooey deliciousness, but I will say that. But fat bag is like the poor man's bacon. And where I grew up, you ate fat bag.
Really?
Yeah, and it's really just like fat and very little meat.
Yeah.
But you put it in your collard greens, you fry it up and put it on, you know, a piece of white bread with some mayonnaise. And I mean, it's just kind of one of those things that you eat it as a snack. It can be a main meal. It's an accompaniment to, you know, your beans that you're making. But I did not know that it was that it wasn't like, one, that it was really unhealthy for you, and two, that you probably shouldn't eat it every day. Like,
Yeah, that's good. Well, is there
you want people slide in your DMs?
Yeah, I was gonna say, is there any way that you want people to get a hold of you, or what? what would you want, like, people that are listening to this and they want to reach out, or they want to be involved in your campaign, or they want to help in some way? How would they go about doing that?
Or they find a dead body?
Oh God! If don't they find a dead body, in your yard. You know, you should probably be calling 911.
Save you some paperwork.
No, if people want to reach out to me, they certainly can slide into my DMs, as long as it's not for anything nefarious. And no, I don't want to date anyone's husband, boyfriend, or friends. Don't try to hook me up with anybody. That annoys me. But if you're sliding into my DMs for healthy things, then they can reach me at Nada Rutherford, NAIDA. RUTHERFORD, or you can find me on TikTok at Madam Coroner, and I'm on LinkedIn as Nada Rutherford as well.
And if we start a dating show, do you want to be on that?
I want you to hear this clearly. Hell no.
Okay, we'll put you down.
I will fight you in the
Thank you so much. This has been great.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate you having me.
Here.
We're here for the health of it.
For the health of it.